lovers, we'll marry our fortunes together. I've got some real estate here in my bag. So we bought a pack of cigarettes and Mrs. Wagner pie and walk off to look for America. Kathy has said as we boarded a Greyhound in Pittsburgh, Michigan seems like a dream to me now. It took me 4 days to hitchhike from Saginaw. I've come to look for America. Laughing on the bars, playing games with the faces. She said the man in the gabardine suit was a spy. I said be careful, his bow tie is really a camera. Toss me a cigarette, I think there's one in my raincoat. We smoked the last one an hour ago. So I looked at the scenery. She read her magazine. Lost. I said, though I knew she was sleeping, I'm empty and aching, and I don't know why. Counting the cars on the New Jersey Turnpike, they've all come to look for America.
Good job, Barry. Next song you'll know. Feel free to sing along with us. Welcome. This is Born in the USA.
Hit the ground, the black door that's been beat too much to you.
continue with some familiar songs. Feel free to sing along and join us whenever the Spirit feels right. We're coming together for such a good reason to learn and to be in each other's company. I think you'll recognize this one. It's called What's Up.
5 years of my life is still I'm trying to get up that great big hill of hope for a destination.
All right, we're bringing a little Stevie Wonder in.
Many
Thank you. That's Love's in Need. We're all in need of a little. Another one is You Gotta Be. Try to keep your head up to the sky. Lovers, they may cause you fears. Go ahead, release your fears. Stand up and be counted. Don't be ashamed to cry. You gotta be bad. You gotta be bold. You gotta be wiser. You gotta be hard. You gotta be tough. You gotta be stronger. Lovers, they may cause you tears, but go ahead, release your fears. My, oh my, yeah. Great to see you all here, and welcome. If this is home for you, welcome home. If it's a new space, welcome. You're welcome. Our final song before we introduce our incredible speaker is For What It's Worth, a Buffalo Springfield, led by Barry.
Something happened here. What it is ain't exactly clear. There's a man with a gun over there telling me I've got to beware. I think it's time we stop. Children, what's that sound? Everybody look what's going down. We'll be right back. strong. Nobody's right if everybody's wrong. Young people speak in their minds, getting so much resistance from behind. I think it's time to stop cheering. What's that sound? Everybody look what's going down. What a field day for the year. A thousand people in the streets, singing song and carrying signs, mostly singing hooray for our side. I think it's time to stop cheering. What's that sound? Everybody look what's going down. Paranoia strikes deep into your life, it will creep. It stops when you're always afraid. Step out of line, the man comes and take you away. I think it's time we stop children. What's that sound? Everybody look what's going down. It's time we stop children. What's that sound? Everybody look what's going down. Stop children. What's that sound? Everybody look what's going down. Stop children. What's that sound? Everybody look. It's time we stop shooting. What's that sound? Everybody look what's going down. It's time to stop shooting. What's that sound? Everybody look what's going down. It's time to stop shooting. What's that sound? Everybody look what's going down. It's time to stop shooting. What's that sound? Everybody look what's going down.
Thanks for being here, everybody. It's great to see you all.
And welcome good friends and guests to the Bethel Speaker Series, and what a great night we have tonight. I mean, to have the Bethel band put us in the mood for some good conversation, some good insightful presentation. So this is Catherine Stewart night, and I first became aware of Catherine Stewart about this time last year at the Bethel Homeless Summit for Madison, when one of our guests, a member at Midville Lutheran Community, was talking about a book she had just read with some people at the church there. This book here by Catherine, the Power Worshipper. So I just went out there and bought it and read it and said, oh my gosh, we got to see if we can't get her to come and share her insights and her thoughts and her research with us. So just stalked her a little bit on Facebook and on Google and found out how to connect with her. And well, she was so willing and gracious in her time and her travel. So Catherine is an investigative reporter, and she writes about religious liberty, politics, policy, and education. She has had her work appear in the New York Times as an op-ed, and in the New Republic, The Guardian. She's written for the American Prospect, for George Washington University's History News Network. She's written for The Nation, Reuters, The Atlantic, Newsweek, Rolling Stone, The New York Observer, Santa Barbara Magazine, and Religion Dispatches. She's had her work published far and wide to rave reviews. She has developed some expertise in the controversies over religious freedom and the separation of church and state. So this book that she has written most recently is precisely about that, and particularly as it focuses on the rise of religious or Christian nationalism. So Christian nationalism is the focus for some of our conversations at Bethel the next few Sundays, and Catherine will hit upon that as well. It's a pseudo-religious movement that uses religion, Christianity, as a strategy for a power grab politically. But she'll tell us more about that. So without any further ado, please welcome Catherine Stewart.
Hi, thank you so much for having me. Thanks for that beautiful introduction. My name is Catherine Stewart. I'm really honored to be here. I want to thank you, Pastor Brown, and the Bethel Lutheran Church for hosting me this evening. I'm thrilled and humbled to speak to a community with such a rich intellectual tradition, a commitment to peace and justice, and a dedication to unity and healing. My great aunt Anne, who I loved dearly, used to say to me, "Honey, when you're with company, don't talk about religion and politics." But here we are. I apologize. I also remember she used to like to go on walks. But the thing is, she never really quite seemed to know where she was headed. And I would say, "Aunt Anne, where are we going?" And she would say, "How are we going to know until we get there?" And life is like that a bit, isn't it? I was thinking about that problem of not really understanding where you're going, where the destination is until you've arrived, as I was coming here this evening, because I was remembering the moment that my own journey in this area began about 14 years ago. I never really could have predicted it would take me here tonight to the Bethel Lutheran Church, speaking with all of you about all the things that my Aunt Anne never told me to never talk about. So tonight I want to tell you about my journey, what I've learned, and why it matters. I want to talk a bit about hope, and then I want to hear from you. But first, let me tell you what happened to me. In 2009, my husband and I were living in Santa Barbara, California. Our daughter was in the first grade, our little boy was a baby, and something happened that at first seemed too small to ignore. Until all of a sudden it was too big to ignore. We learned that a Good News Club was coming to our public elementary school. Good News Clubs are after-school clubs that target children in their very earliest years of learning with the message that if they don't believe in Jesus, they're going to go to hell, and sort of seeks to inculcate them into a fundamentalist form of evangelical Christianity. Now we're talking little kids here. A centerpiece of the program of these clubs is called the Wordless Book. It's used to convert children who are too young to read. It has no words, just pictures and shapes. And the clubs are basically designed to tell the kids that, you know, they not only need to believe a certain way, but that they need to go to a right kind of church. I remember a lady in my community told me her daughter came home and said, "Mommy, we're going to go to hell because we don't go to the right kind of church." In our community, I saw how these clubs confused these very little kids into thinking that their public school endorsed their religion. Little kids cannot make a distinction between what is taught in their school and what is sponsored by their school. They, you know, public schools have a cloak of authority in their minds. They think that if it's taught in their school by adults, you know, who they're taught to respect, it must be what the school and, frankly, the state wants them to believe. I saw how these adults who are leading these clubs were using their position inside the schools to get kids attending the clubs to target their non-Christian peers, or those attending the supposedly wrong kinds of churches or houses of worship, for what I could only describe as faith-based bullying and bigotry. Now, our school was down the road from Westmont College. It's an evangelical college. So the parent body at our school was perhaps a third to a half evangelical. But here's the thing that really set off alarm bells for me. As far as I could tell, The evangelical parents, at least the ones that I knew, did not want a Good News Club at our school. A group of the Westmont moms got together, And they met with the Good News Club leaders. They said, we are evangelical too. We believe in the Great Commission, but you're not right for our school. We'd like to offer you free and better space in the evangelical church that was next door to the school, at the same time, for free. And it was an absolutely beautiful church. It's stunning, you know. And the Good News Club leaders declined. And that really got me asking some questions. I thought, why didn't my evangelical friends want a Good News Club at our school? Why did the club leaders insist on being in the public school when such a lovely space had been offered to them? What did they believe? And how was it possible for them to operate in the public schools in the first place, given the constitutional principle of the separation of church and state? So that's really where my journey began. I learned that there were thousands of these Good News Clubs operating in public schools nationwide. And yet, here's what astonished me. Leaders of the Good News Club and their sponsoring organization, which is called the Child Evangelism Fellowship, they appeared to view public education with contempt. They were using public school classrooms, classrooms and facilities that we, the taxpayers, had built and paid for and maintained. And yet they disparaged these classrooms. They said that what they called government schools, that's what they called public schools, they said government schools were a consequence of evil, scenes of spiritual battle. They called our schools mission fields, and they called other people's children the harvest. I came to realize that their efforts were just one small part of a much larger attack on public education. I published a book on that topic in 2012, and over the years, I kept writing and digging deeper. I discovered that the attack on public ed was just one small part of a much larger attack on America as a modern constitutional democracy. So then I made an effort to bring an understanding of this movement that I will call Christian nationalism to a broader audience. And here's where some of my real learning began, because the discoveries and the ways in which they played out did not always unfold in the ways that I would have anticipated. So today, I want to talk about that. I want to talk about some of those discoveries. I'd like to discuss Christian nationalism and religious nationalism more broadly. But first, let's talk about what Christian nationalism is and what it is not. Christian nationalism is not Christianity. It is not a religion. It is a political phenomenon that involves the exploitation of religion for political purposes. I think of it as combining two things. On the one hand, it is a set of ideas, an ideology. On the other hand, it is a political movement, an organized quest for political power. As an ideology, Christian nationalism boils down to the idea that the United States was founded as a Christian nation, but the word Christian here, of course, referring to a conservative or fundamentalist conception of Christianity, frankly, one particular interpretation or a set of very particular interpretations of Christianity. And it's the idea that all of our problems as a nation stem from the fact that we have forsaken the supposed heritage of that founding. But this ideology is really just a tool. It is the most useful tool for a political machine that turns that story into political power. The machinery consists of right-wing policy groups, legal advocacy groups, pastoral organizations, you know, organizations that networking organizations for pastors that, you know, bring them all on the same page and get them to turn their congregations out to vote for so-called biblical values, a very specific set of what are identified as biblical values. Many biblical values, of course, are lost in this process. Networking organizations that get the leadership of the movement on the same page, legislative and data initiatives and a vast messaging sphere, all of the features of modern political campaigns. It is a means, Christian nationalism is a means of persuading a large subsection of American voters to support the political candidates that the movement favors, the political candidates that will do what they want the movement to do. And this way, it's a way of empowering movement leaders and enshrining the policies that they want in our laws and society. So here's something to know about those two aspects of Christian nationalism, the ideology and the organized quest for power. The movement is radically anti-democratic, both in its fundamental ideas and in its method of acting. It says that the foundation of legitimate government in the United States is in a particular interpretation or approved set of interpretations of the Christian religion, and insists that that's what makes us distinctive, rather than our constitution or our democratic system of government or our long, if imperfect, history of assimilating very diverse people in a pluralist society. The movement rejects the principles of equality and justice that represent the best of the American promise. So they are driving support for an agenda that most Christians would view as antithetical to the gospel. Christian nationalism is a way of dividing people between the supposedly righteous and the supposedly unrighteous, the pure versus the impure, the insiders versus the outsiders. That is what religious nationalist leaders do around the world. I think sometimes it's easier to see when it's happening in other countries. When a leader like Vladimir Putin in Russia, or Viktor Orban in Hungary, or Erdogan in Turkey, or leaders in Iran, when they bind themselves tightly to ultra-conservative religious figures in their own countries to consolidate authoritarian forms of political power, we rightly recognize this as religious nationalism. These leaders use religious nationalism to bubble wrap themselves in sanctimony, to guard against any democratic check on their power or critique of their corruption or cronyism or nepotism. And they use religious nationalism to shield themselves from transparency regarding any abuses that they may be perpetrating against their own people, the denial of rights and other terrible abuses that they may be perpetrating. When I was growing up, I never imagined we'd see this kind of religious nationalism, or ethno-nationalism, is sometimes another way of thinking about it, being weaponized in America in this way in my lifetime. And frankly, I don't think my great aunt Anne did either. And yet the weaponization of religious nationalism in our politics and our laws has become too dangerous to ignore. It's something we need to grapple with. As a country, we're polarized as never before. It's become so hard for many of us to communicate across political lines, even sometimes within families. I don't know about you, but some of our Thanksgiving dinners are challenging. But it is something we need to grapple with, because I think we do better when we can communicate with one another. Here's something you already know. Christian nationalism is damaging to both faith and the nation. By fusing certain types of Christianity with partisanship, movement leaders are damaging both the political system and religion. I think the political damage is in some ways easier to see. By locking a base of voters around an absolute non-negotiable set of positions, movement leaders effectively exploit conservative Christians and the Republican Party itself, and use them to advance their many agendas unchecked. This is not just a culture war. This is a political war. And movement leaders have a broad set of agendas relating economic agendas, social agendas, cultural agendas, of course, agendas that they're pushing through the courts. So what does this look like? Well, if movement leaders want the help of a very sort of specific cadre, a subsection of very hyper-wealthy funders to advance their aims, and they sure do, can talk about more that about that later, they will favor lower taxes for the super rich and minimal rights for the workforce. But how do they get the rank and file to support, you know, the kinds of economic policies that are widening, you know, intensifying economic inequality in their country, they're going to get the rank and file to vote on abortion. The little people, if we can get them to vote on abortion, they'll support the politicians that are, you know, hollowing out the rights for the workforce and reducing taxes for the hyper-rich. If movement leaders want to hollow out health care or get rid of Social Security, get the rank and file in a panic over same-sex marriage. The religious right claims to stand for family values, but the movement is driving support for politicians whose far-right economic policies are making it harder for too many American families to succeed. This hostage-taking of the Republican Party by Christian nationalist leaders also licenses the corruption of political leaders. For example, well, we're in a church, and I'm not going to mention any particular names, but there is nothing that certain political leaders could not steal or taint, no amount of bigotry they could enable, no amount of violence they could incite that was unacceptable as long as those leaders appoint pro-life justices, work to direct the flow of taxpayer funding to right-wing religious organizations. But, you know, I think it's the damage to religion that doesn't get enough attention. This kind of politicized religion becomes remarkably binary in that it demonizes political opponents and deifies its favored political leaders. It also is intrinsically doomed to failure and frustration because it's tying its religious or eternal aspirations to circumstantial developments in the political arena. And in the face of inevitable losses, which are going to happen in a nation as inevitably pluralistic and diverse as ours, this type of religion is likely to become very embittered and nihilistic and may take a very sort of negative view of the world, which may lead to greater radicalization still. Those who have been observing this movement for some time were aware that Christian nationalists are committed to a project that could lead to the overthrow of American democracy. Listen, I have to say it, but now with a coup attempt, along with theft of hundreds of classified documents pertaining to our national security and the movement leaders' defense of some of these things, I feel we've crossed a Rubicon. Movement leaders are committed to the pursuit of power at all costs, even where it quite clearly involves rebellion against the American government and the American constitutional system. So we're at an extremely dangerous point, and I think there is nothing in American history that is quite like this. So the first lesson I want to draw from my experience is listen to what they say. Listening is underrated. I think that movement leaders are not hiding, it's that we're not listening, or sometimes we reframe what we hear in ways that are intended to make us feel more comfortable. It's really hard to hear what people say and take them at their word, isn't it? We're inclined to try to hear something else or think it's metaphorical so that we can pretend we're not seeing what's actually there. We should try to resist that impulse. A decade ago, you could not use terms like Christian nationalism without inviting accusations of alarmism. When people brought up the extreme teachings of some movement leaders, the response from the mainstream commentators was that this was a fringe phenomenon. These are just a few crazies at the margins. One prominent commentator called the Christian right and the more sort of radical aspects of it a movement that could fit into a phone booth. Well, the phone booth was installed in the White House in 2016. It refused to leave in 2020, and threatens to return in 2024. But it's not a phone booth, by the way. It's stadiums all across the country. This is a movement that has taken over one of our two major political parties, and the time has come to set aside dismissals. Here's another lesson I draw from the past decade and a half. Extremes don't correct themselves. You know, people talk a lot about the pendulum, and it swings one way and it swings another as though this is somehow a magical process, and if it swings too far in one direction, it's bound to go in the other direction. You know, it's natural. We often approach the political world and history itself through the lens of progress. We think the bad stuff will eventually fade away so the good stuff can come forward. You know, two steps forward, one step back, two steps forward again. But that hasn't happened with this movement. The movement is actually getting ideologically harder and more extreme as it moves into the future. Two decades ago, an ideology called Seven Mountains Dominionism was considered so fringe, so radical, that it was never allowed near the podium with Republican political speakers and leaders. Now that same ideology is a heartbeat away from much of what happens in our politics at the, well, let me tell you what Seven Mountains Dominionism is first. It's the conviction that Christians of a certain hyper-conservative variety should rightfully dominate the main peaks of modern civilization in the United States and ultimately the world. The ideology reportedly got its start in 1975 when several missionary leaders allegedly heard messages from God telling them to invade the seven spheres or mountains or molders of culture, which by their reckoning include government, media, education, business, entertainment, religion. According to the late C. Peter Wagner, a key proponent of the ideology, and family is one of those. So late C. Peter Wagner, he's considered a godfather of this movement. He said the responsibility for conservative Christians to take over whatever molder of culture or subdivision God has placed them in is really a matter of, quote, taking dominion back from Satan. The language and ideas of dominionism have penetrated into the mainstream of the movement. So over the past 14 years of doing research into this movement, a lot of the way I do my work is I go to right-wing conferences and strategy gatherings and summits. And I want to tell you what I'm hearing at the most, some of the most recent gatherings. At the 2021 Road to Majority Conference, it's a key gathering of the right-wing activists and strategists and affiliated politicians. Florida Governor Ron DeSantis alluded to a passage from Ephesians that is used to invoke the idea of a spiritual war against the devil. He said, you've got to put on the full armor of God. You've got to take a stand against the left's schemes. For those of you who are familiar with the passage, the passage from Ephesians uses the word the devil rather than the left. So when he's speaking in this way, everybody knows that he's equating people who happen to take a different political view from him, which will include everybody from moderate Republicans to, you know, liberals, progressive, whatever, that sort of big tent, he's equating with the devil. The conference the following year, U.S. Representative from Texas, Louis Gohmert, said, we are soldiers in God's army engaged in spiritual warfare for our country. We can fight or fail. It's like very hard language, isn't it? Other speakers inveighed that America's on the precipice, careening toward a, quote, socialist revolution, anarchy, chaos, and is under the thumb of the most despicable human beings imaginable, namely the other political party, who were referred to as the enemy, satanic, and agents of evil. Agents of evil. You know, former President Trump, this is what he said. He spoke at the conference. He said, the greatest danger to America is not our enemies from the outside, as powerful as they may be. The greatest danger to America is the destruction of our nation from the people within, and you know the people I'm talking about. Senator Rick Scott of Florida said, the backlash is coming, and warned, just mount up and ride to the sound of the guns. They are all over this country. It is time to take this country back. Folks, this is not normal. This kind of language, this kind of identifying fellow Americans as an internal enemy that is demonic, is not normal. Which brings up a third point I want to share today. We should be very careful of efforts to normalize extremism. Prior to January 6th, frankly, I would not have predicted that one of our major political parties would have enabled and then effectively endorsed an attempted coup against the American democratic system. I realized in retrospect, however, that I should hardly have been surprised hadn't I been listening to what they were saying, to what the movement leaders who were basically seized control of this party were saying. And then I realized I too had been taken in by normalizers or efforts to sort of just portray this as part of the normal give and take of politics. But it's not. There are some commentators who will watch a crime taking place or corruption taking place and then tell you it's politics as usual. When groups of people riot or assault the Capitol and call for the deaths of public officials, they say, that's okay. They're just expressing their political frustration, exercising their First Amendment rights. When the FBI executes a search warrant as part of a criminal investigation into espionage. And one group says, it's the FBI that needs to be arrested. They're the ones at fault. There are folks who are going to try to frame this as a partisan political conflict and rush to get opinions from both sides. Folks, this is not normal, but you know that. We just shouldn't forget it. I want to offer one last little insight, a little more complicated perhaps than the last. The political strength of the Christian nationalist movement does not come from its ideas. You know, a lot of times people talk about the movement as though these ideas sort of sprung up from the heartland. All of a sudden, the rank and file had this set of ideas, you know, magically sort of developed them all together. But that's not how it happened. In fact, I think any decent historian can challenge the Christian nationalist founding myth and poke significant holes in it in under 10 minutes. The strength of the movement comes from its unity, and the unity comes mainly from the top down. The leaders of the movement have a very long-range political vision. And over the past 5 decades, we've seen how they have methodically and patiently built up the machinery that has brought us to this present crisis. So for 5 decades, they've invested in those different pieces of infrastructure, the right-wing policy groups, the legal advocacy groups, the networking organizations, the data initiatives, the legislative initiatives. And yes, there is a leadership cadre. Many people say, who are the leaders? Well, the thing is that the movement is so strong because one leader can retire or fall out or get caught up in a scandal or have a change of heart, whatever it may be. But there's already an organization that sort of serves to bring new leaders forth, and there's a lot of cultivation of leadership within this movement. So if you have organizations rather than individuals leading pieces of this infrastructure, it makes it a lot stronger. And they cultivate the attitudes of the rank and file really from the top down. There are so many examples we could use to talk about this. One of the most clearest examples is, critical race theory. I think before 2020, there was some study where they said before November 2020, there were only three, or maybe it was before February 2020, can't remember the exact month, there were only three or four references to critical race theory on Fox News ever of all time. And then within like a three-month span, there were thousands of references. You know, the sort of leaders get together and they do their work, they do their, focus groups, they figure out the culture war issues that are going to work with the rank and file, and all of a sudden it's like, okay, we're all going to talk about this, and then everybody's talking about it. So to illustrate this, I want to make another point with respect to the abortion issue, but of course it applies much more broadly than that. When people today try to explain how abortion became such a salient issue in American politics, they typically fall back on the explanation that there are some socially conservative people, mostly religious, who've ever and always opposed abortion, who have ever and always believed that life begins at conception or fertilization, and who made banning abortion their cause immediately after the Supreme Court decision in 1973. But that story is false. The reality is much more complex. When Roe versus Wade passed in 1973, abortion was not an issue for most American Protestant denominations. At the time, the Southern Baptist Convention actually welcomed the decision. They had published statements in 1971 and also 1974 affirming support for abortion law liberalization. And when Roe v. Wade passed in 1973, an op-ed in one of their publications hailed the decision and actually said, this represents a sensible middle ground. Barry Goldwater, that great conservative hero, also supported abortion law liberalization, at least early in his career. This is one of my favorite little factoids. His wife, Peggy Goldwater, co-founded Planned Parenthood in Arizona. Betty Ford hailed Roe versus Wade as a great, great decision. Ronald Reagan passed the most liberal abortion law as governor of California. Billy Graham himself echoed widely held Protestant sentiments when he said in 1968, in general, I would disagree with what he saw as a Catholic stance, and he added, I believe in Planned Parenthood. Billy Graham said that. But the change really took place in the late 1970s and early 1980s when conservative activist leaders, a group that felt the Republican Party had become too liberal, too soft on communism. They called themselves the New Right. They were looking for a group that could unite different groups and oppose what they saw as these liberal trends. They were also very upset about a liberal direction of religion in America as well, with figures like Paul Tillich becoming so, so his teachings becoming so widespread. And, there's this fascinating episode where leaders of what would become the new religious right got together and basically went down a laundry list of the issues that they thought might unite their new movement. So we're talking about 1980 or so, about 7 years after Roe versus Wade. Number one was they were very upset about the civil rights movement and certain aspects of it. They felt that religious segregated academies led by people like Bob Jones were being unfairly targeted by the IRS, which was threatening to take away some of their tax privileges. But, let's, preserve the tax privileges for segregated schools wasn't really an effective rallying cry for their movement. They looked at some other issues, school prayer, but it tended to alienate the ultra-conservative Catholics that they were allied with. The women's rights movement was another. But they rejected those issues one by one for a variety of reasons. But when they got to abortion, it was like a light bulb went off, and they thought, huh, that could actually work. So over time, pro-choice voices were purged from the Republican Party. And Phyllis Schlafly has actually published a terrific and highly descriptive book about that process titled How the Republican Party Became Pro-Life, because see, it wasn't. And she describes how it took several decades for her and other activists to bring Protestant Republicans on board with this very strict, draconian anti-abortion position. And it wasn't easy. It's really a fascinating read. And I recommend this book because it really shows an important part of political history. But what it also shows is that the sort of pro-life religion, the sort of abortion abolitionist ideas that we're seeing in our politics today are really a modern creation, and they were created for political purposes. So I suppose folks who want to ban abortion from the moment of conception really don't care about the thousands, hundreds of thousands of women every year who experience sometimes life-threatening complications and need abortions to preserve their lives or their health. I am actually one of those one of those women who needed an abortion to save my life during a miscarriage that went very badly. And I write about that book, that experience in, I believe it's chapter 11 of Power Worshippers. But the point here is that many Republican politicians privately support more moderate policies, but they've been pushed into embracing the most extreme position on that issue and many others by movement leaders, even though it causes so much harm and so much pain. So now that we've added sex, or at least some of the consequences of sex, to the list of impolite topics that we're discussing this evening, religion, politics, and sex, it's a perfect storm. I want to return to my dear great aunt Anne. Is it still too impolite to discuss religion and politics in company? Maybe. But if we care about our democracy and we care about one another, I don't think we have a choice. Religious nationalism is a political movement that covers itself in religious rhetoric, and that's what makes it so hard to criticize. When we critique the movement, we may be accused of being the enemy of all religion, but we are not, and we have to keep saying that over and over again. Our concern is the manipulation of faith, the weaponization of fear, the demand for obedience, the licensing of corruption, and the ways in which religious nationalism and authoritarianism is being used to divide rather than unite our country. In fact, some of the most powerful critics of Christian nationalism are Christians themselves. I am thinking of groups like Vote Common Good, Christians Against Christian Nationalism, Faithful America, the New Evangelicals, and many others. I am also thinking of the many non-sectarian civil liberties groups that are uniting Americans for the separation of church and state and fighting for the preservation of our individual rights and the integrity of our voting systems, the preservation of democracy itself. I'm thinking about Get Out the Vote initiatives like Souls to the Polls and so many others. There is simply no substitute for getting out the vote. I think of the words of Ralph Reed. He's one of the movement's most seasoned and astute religious rights strategists. He pulled together that conference, the Road to Majority conference. He does it every year. And at one of those conferences, he said, pay no attention to the polls. Our numbers are shrinking. All that matters is who turns out on election day. He's right about that. I also think about the words of David Barton, a fellow I wrote about at length in The Power Worshippers. I call him the Where's Waldo of the Christian nationalist movement because he's everywhere. He's on legislative initiatives, pastoral initiatives, political initiatives. He's doing these sort of patriot academies and the like. He wrote some time ago, commit yourself to this engagement for the long haul, for the duration. Arm yourself with the mentality of a marathon runner, not a sprinter. He's right about that. Together, we can invest in the infrastructure of our democracy, from our courts to healthcare to education. We can't forget that much of politics is local, whether it's our local school board, our town hall, our courthouse, or our state house. Now, I'm often asked, where do you find hope? I think of the words of the Reverend Kelly Brown Douglas. She's the dean of the Episcopal Divinity School at Union Theological Seminary. She said, the hope is in the struggle. She's right. Commit yourself to the long haul. None of us can predict the future, but we're in this together, and everyone has a role to play. Religious nationalists are working to destroy our democracy. I continue to believe that the tools of democracy can be used to restore it. Thank you so much. Thank you. Oh, sorry. Thank you. Would you like me to stay?
Entirely, we'd like to invite some question in maybe 10 to 15 minutes, and we'll ask you to raise your hand if you have a question, or and then I'll invite Catherine to respond to it.
I see you right there in the red shirt with a pink. Oh, I'm so sorry.
Just a quick. I just wonder, like, based on your research, how organized is this movement? Because it seems, sometimes it's business leaders who are coming out with, I know today I heard on NPR a bunch of companies will not pay for health care, that covers, birth control or PrEP, pre-exposure prophylaxis for HIV. And then there are others who are political. So, are the politicians and the business people and the religious people and the family people all meeting together?
It's a great question. The thing that has really astonished me as I've researched the movement is how organized it is. There's a vast sort of, I think to a largely underappreciated degree, a lot of the strategy is actually coming from the legal sphere. So there's legal advocacy organizations like the Alliance Defending Freedom, which has an annual operating budget of, I think it was $102 million fiscal year, 2021. I heard that actually from the Vice President of Communications from the Alliance Defending Freedom. So I think about the Federalist Society, which has played an outsized role in shaping our courts. All six conservative justices on the Supreme Court are current or former members of the Federalist Society. So they're doing, there's a Pacific Justice Institute, ACLJ, there's a vast right, sort of far right legal sphere that is doing a lot of the strategizing. I think about organizations like the Council for National Policy. This is one of the movement's leading networking organizations. It brings together the leaders of different organizations. And we're talking like, major leaders of, of the Alliance Defending Freedom or the Federal Society or Family Research Council, the American Family Association, the Leadership Institute, so many others, brings them together with the funders. There's a tremendous amount of coordination. I think about legislative initiatives like Project Blitz, which craft model legislation intended to degrade or degrade the separation of church and state, or conflate in the minds of the public a certain religious viewpoint with the authority of government. Then they introduce these sort of pieces of this legislation to politicians who are favorable to the movement's agenda, and then they will sort of, it's like a shock and awe. They're all introducing In God We Trust bills in multiple states all at the same time. I mean, there are so many examples of how the movement is organized in the power worshipers. I think about it almost like a watch, and I want to take the back off the watch so people could see how the machinery works, how the different components of the machinery work together, how the data organizations work hand in glove with some of the, faith-based organizations, with some of the policy groups and the like. A lot of that machinery is intended to turn out the vote. And the strength of the movement really is because they act in that unity, and they manage to turn out the vote in disproportionate numbers.
You didn't mention racism as part of this, but I have read a number of things that feel that that's an important part of this Christian nationalism as well. it's white rather than anything else.
I'm sorry, can you please repeat the question?
I said you have not mentioned racism and the idea that it is a white movement in a sense.
Yeah,
would you comment on that?
Yeah, thank you for that amazing question. The movement, the racial picture is simple and yet it's complex. So I'll try and, you know, the movement draws on certainly from the ideology of Christian nationalism has deep roots in a racist past. I think about pro-slavery theologians like Robert Louis Dabney or James Henley Thornwell, these leaders of major denominations that were defending, or at least on the side of slaveholders, defending slavery, who had this idea of America as an authentically Christian nation with laws that should be rooted in the Bible, insisting on a strict biblical literalism and hierarchies determined by God. White people over black people, men over women. And so that sort of reactionary interpretation of religion, there's a through line, you know, to today. I think about some of the defenders of segregation, like Bob Jones, who called, you know, segregation God's established order. And I think about a lot of the fact that the movement is driving support for politicians who are intent on race-based voter suppression and gerrymandering, right? Making it harder to vote in districts where they're, you know, disproportionately occupied by people of color, gerrymandering often along, you know, these racially determined maps that are, you know, a way of denying people the right to vote. I think about sort of the insider versus outsider, pure versus impure. That dynamic has been used in our country to view people of color as the outsiders, the impure, right? But here's where it gets complex. Movement leaders can see the demographic future as clearly as you or I can. And they recognize that the movement can't really continue to succeed if it remains all white. So the leaders with the most vision, I'm thinking about people like Ralph Reed, have made an effort to bring in conservative-leaning pastors of color in order to, number one, produce the appearance of diversity, and also, number two, get some number of their congregations when they can do it. So if you look at demographics and voting demographics, things get a little bit more complex and shift a little bit. But absolutely, this kind of idea of America as, you know, I think for a lot of the white people in the movement, the idea of a Christian nation in their minds is implicitly, if not explicitly, a white Christian nation. I hope that answers your question.
I understand that the Koch brothers have stepped back, perhaps, in giving funds to the far extreme right. Should we be encouraged?
Their movement has such a large cadre of funders. So I'm thinking, you know, the Koch brothers, I don't have the data in front of me, but I've heard that they've stepped back in some ways and yet stepped forward in other ways. But you know, I would think about big funders of this movement as, for instance, the DeVos Prince family juggernaut. You know, it's an incredibly wealthy family. Betsy DeVos, of course, was former President Trump's Secretary of Education. I think about the Wilkes brothers, sort of big fracking billionaires, the Green family, the Hobby Lobby family, Sean Feiler. I mean, there's so many other big funders of this movement, whether or not the Kochs are involved in any particular initiative doesn't particularly matter. A lot of the funding these days goes through donor-advised funds. So for instance, there's one called the National Christian Foundation, which gives a lot of money to, say, the Family Research Council, some of the policy groups. And they dispersed, I think, in one recent year, $1.5 billion. It's a lot of money. I think about an initiative funded by a family, the Lindsay family, an initiative called Faith Wins, where they bring David Barton and some other, you know, Chad Connolly and some other movement leaders together. They do presentations at churches. They've done hundreds of presentations, drawing together multiple pastors. I went to one in Virginia, and they give them all the sort of Christian Nation talking points. They tell these pastors, you need to get politically involved. You need to get your congregations to vote biblical values, which inevitably boil down to abortion, same-sex marriage, etc. They tell them the church is not a cruise ship, it's a battleship. That's what they said. The church is not a cruise ship, it's a battleship. And they had with them an elections integrity specialist named Hogan Gidley, a former member of the Trump administration, who was there to spread election lies, talk about how many dead people are voting. And he said, you saw what happened in Arizona. This was after the investigation by a bunch of Republicans who found nothing. And he's still promoting that lie to this group of pastors and saying, you know, we're in a crisis, you need to get your congregations involved. So the Lindsays, I get back to my point, these funders, the Lindsays, I was like, okay, who are these people? I gotta look them up. They own multiple homes. One of their homes was for sale for $72 million. One of their homes. I mean, you see, the amounts of wealth involved in these initiatives are really staggering. And that's why, you know, if you're getting all this, I think a lot of the big funders are as committed, if not more committed, to far-right economic policies. But again, how are they going to get rank and file to vote for the politicians who are going to implement those policies? Get them upset about abortion. You know, the gay couple, nice gay couple down the road, they're coming for your marriage. That's how they do it.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for your presentation. I don't want to walk out of here feeling really numb, because I do when I hear about what that side is doing. Can you talk at all about any sort of grassroots movements within the church and without the church that are beginning to form a resistance to this and grow it?
Thanks for that question. There is a lot of grassroots and leadership-driven resistance to this movement. I think a lot of folks are really concerned among people of faith and also among people who may or may not be members of religious congregations, but are deeply concerned about our democracy. I'm starting to see more organizing, more activism than there has been in quite a long time. And I think, frankly, these policies that the movement leaders want are really unpopular, and that's why they're coming for our right to vote. That's why they've been so intent on gerrymandering, introducing ridiculous laws in states like you can't bring somebody a glass of water if she's been standing in line for 8 hours. How on earth or you can't bring them a chair to sit on? I mean, this makes voting impossible for so many Americans who just can't do that. You know, they're also determined to, you know, steal elections. This is a movement that denies the legitimacy of elections whose consequences they don't like. And that sets the stage for, another coup attempt. I mean, if you attack our voting rights, you are attacking the foundations of our democracy. America is a country that's founded, you know, to serve of the people, by the people, and for the people. And our voting really matters, so we should defend the vote, and many groups are trying to do that.
Thank you for everything. I have so many questions, but I'll just ask one. Do you think that we have, or do you think that this country maybe needs more political parties, or would that make things too chaotic?
That's a great question. It's complicated. I mean, it's never, you can never know how that's going to play out. I think about somebody like Ross Perot and how he tipped the election, frankly, in favor of the Democrats. And I think about somebody like, I don't know, Ralph Nader. And I think about all the other sort of third party candidates. And sometimes, listen, I'm not a political strategist, but what I have observed is sometimes people will introduce a third party thinking it's going to do one thing and it ends up doing something different.
My faith is in the younger generation coming up, and they're actually leaving the church. So is there a certain demographic in this Christian nationalism? If the young people are not involved, how is this group reaching out to young people?
The movement is very youth-focused, and they have many organizations that try to cultivate youth. I'm thinking, for instance, of Students for Life of America. You know, I went to the last National Pro-Life Summit and March for Life in Washington, D.C., and you see lots of kids, you know, a lot of schools, religious schools send their young people there to participate in the march. Some of the kids told me that it wasn't optional. It's really something that they all had to do. Like, okay, now you're all going to do this. And they try to sort of cultivate youth in all these different ways. David Barton runs, and his crew run, these Patriot Academies. But I also think that the movement is really panicked about the fact that many young people see through it. And they're like, this is hypocritical. This is, you know, divisive. You know, we don't agree with the, you know, demonization of our fellow Americans in this way, and are moving away from it. And that's one of the reasons why the movement is so focused on kids and on public education. They know that if you can get the kids, you can get the kingdom. I read a book by a movement strategist named Louis Bush. I don't know if any of you are familiar with his work. He came up with the term the 414 window, which is the area north longitude, you know, I'm sorry, the 10, what's it, 1040 window? But 1040 strategy is an area between 10 and 40 north longitude where the most sort of unchurched people are, you know, live. And so, you know, missionaries were dispatched to that part of the globe where there are these sort of groups where there's, you know, least amount of Christianity. But then he also came up with this idea of the 414 window, meaning kids between the ages of 4 and 14. He said, you know, even, you know, this is the area when people's religious identities are being formed, and we need to focus on this, make this a focus of our mission strategy. So he published a book about it called The 414 Window. And in the introduction, it says, I don't have it in front of me, so I'm going to paraphrase. It said, you know, even the Taliban places a great emphasis, you know, even Nazism, the Taliban places a great emphasis on recruiting children, talking about these, like, really, you know, and then said, may God inspire you to join his battle for the little ones. And it really shows that the idea of, you know, we're all free to educate our children in our faith traditions if we like or if we have them. But this is, you know, going after other people's kids in public schools is something else. They're viewing, again, you know, our public schools as their mission fields and other people's children as the harvest.
That was my question too. It was about youth. I noticed this crowd is pretty gray, and when I go to other political events or rallies in Madison, it's mostly gray-headed people. And so I just was wondering how aware you were of the movement for young people to counteract some of these things, because I think, like you said, they are cynical. I was actually invited to this by a younger person who ended up not being able to come. But I do, since that question was already asked, I do have another question. I just wanted to know your opinion about the speech that Biden just gave, where he was trying to address the crowd of people that I won't also won't name, you know, for wanting to tear down our democracy. And in your opinion, do you think it was or will be effective?
His speech, whether the speech, well, it's interesting that he used the sort of the word fascism. And the word fascism is sometimes, listen, if you look at this movement, it conforms with a lot of the definitions of fascism. An authoritarian, rejection of the idea of voting, rejection of the idea of equality, emphasis on obedience, on a strict obedience, allowing political leaders to commit crimes without holding them accountable. That conforms to the definition of fascism, but the word fascism inspires so much debate itself, whether it's politically, whether it's historically accurate, whether it's, sometimes the debate can get in the way. But, you know, a lot of different people use a lot of different terms to describe what we're seeing in our politics today. I think everybody comes from a different place and has a different sort of history in life and a different understanding. What matters more than what we call it is that we're clear on what it is that we're describing, you know, what we're seeing.
So I think we'll have one more, and then we'll close out the Q&A time.
Thanks, Mike. Is climate change denial, is that baked into this nationalist point of view? And why is it? Is there some counter movements within the broad spectrum of people who have this point of view? Is there any way to talk to them about, the climate problem? I think there's an inherent distrust of government action, but is there a built-in ideological denial of climate change, denial of the need for action, and so forth, that can perhaps be, well, mitigated through dialogue or something?
That's a great question. You know, there's this organization called the Cornwall Alliance for the Stewardship of Creation, and it is a climate denial organization. It's, you know, they have a sort of statement that's signed by a very large number of these religious right leaders. The movement is very much into climate denial, and they actually produced a series about environmentalism, calling it the Green Dragon. You know, basically, the implication is that environmentalism is satanic, another religion, you know, a disgrace. And movement leaders have received funding from many folks who are also themselves climate deniers, perhaps because they want minimal regulation of business, minimal regulation of the environment, or no regulation of the environment. So that's deeply concerning. It does appear to be very much a part of the movement. But there are other faith-based organizations that are environmental and that are trying to, they call themselves often creation care. They believe that they sort of anchor their concern for dedication to taking care of the environment in part in their faith and are not climate denialists. But a lot of the not policy groups, like the think tanks, like I'm thinking about, like the Mackinac Center, the Heartland Institute, that work with some folks who are sort of within this movement, are also producing materials that are climate denial. I mean, we think about the Discovery Institute out in Seattle, which is very much a sort of feature of this movement. And when I was at a gathering out in Seattle, sort of religious nationalist gathering out there, there was a sort of program for the kids, and they were taking them on a tour of the Discovery Museum. So it's very much a part of it.
This is really the last one.
You've made many references to violence, and white Christian nationalism is just associated with it dramatically from January 6th, and from Senator from South Carolina and many other politicians in the Republican Party talking about, if you don't do this, things are going to get worse, and constant references of violence. I wonder if you yourself might be concerned, as the person who's speaking out about this, that maybe you ought to have some security here tonight. Do you worry about it?
Thanks so much for the question. Well, I just do want to speak to the issue of violence. We can't understand what happened that day without looking at the role of Christian nationalism. The ideology played a role because in the minds of a lot of those folks who assaulted the Capitol, that disgraceful assault, Donald Trump was God's chosen guy. And so if he lost, it must be against God's will. And they've been told they're in an apocalyptic struggle between absolute good and absolute evil. So they're willing to call themselves patriots even as they're attacking the very foundations of our democracy, our electoral system, and our capital. But it's more than that. So the networks of Christian nationalism were deeply involved in perpetuating that violence because there's an organization called the Conservative Action Project. It's connected to the Council for National Policy, that leading networking organization. And they issued a memo a week before the insurrection calling on their people, their allied politicians, to contest the electoral votes from the states that were the subjects of these baseless allegations, like Georgia, Pennsylvania, et cetera. And it was signed by, again, you know, these movement leaders like Tony Perkins and Bob McEwen and so many others who are leading these, you know, these policy groups and these other features, these other organizational features of the movement. So it really shows that the movement is like, we are going to contest the electoral votes. Y'all need to do this. And it's like, you know, the orders come from the top and everybody follows. You know, at those right-wing conferences I've attended, I heard people say, like, you know, we need to defend the January 6th people. We won't defend our guys even when they're good guys, and things like that. You know, talk about how those January 6th insurrectionists were actually, you know, doing the right thing. And this kind of normalization of political violence is deeply concerning, I think, for all of us. We should all be concerned. I'm not worried for myself. I'm worried about our democracy. Thank you.
Well, in closing, I want to do two things. One is to invite you, of course, to stay, get some coffee, and mingle and continue your conversation with each other. And then the coming 3 weeks here at Bethel, we'll have a continued conversation about a faith perspective, a Lutheran faith perspective on our engagement with our world politically. So we'll have some more speakers, professors from regional seminaries and historians to come and lead some adult forums to continue the conversation. So you're all welcome to be a part of that, of course. But thanks for Catherine and Stuart. Please stand up and give her a good round of applause.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Something happening here. What it is ain't exactly clear. There's a man with a gun over there telling me I've got to beware. I think it's time we stop, children. What's that time? Everybody look what's going down. Thank you.
What a field day for the heat. A thousand people in the streets, singing songs and carrying signs, mostly saying hooray for our side. I think it's time we stop. Children, what's that sound? Everybody look what's going down. Paranoia strikes deep into your life, it will creep. It stops.